In oscillators that use op amps, we can pretty much treat the op amp as an ideal amplifier. Op amps have very high input impedance and very low output impedance, so they very closely resemble ideal amplifiers. But op amps have limitations. Op amps, for example, the LM741 op amp, starts to roll off at higher frequencies. In other words, the gain starts to resemble less and less the nominal value that you might calculate as the frequency gets higher. Op amps generally don't work very well at high frequencies. So if we hope to make, for example, a radio frequency oscillator, we're going to want to use a transistor amplifier rather than an op amp. Oscillators like the Weinbridge oscillator or the phase shift oscillator are meant to work at low frequencies. They're meant to work at audio frequencies because they have resistors and capacitors in the feedback network. If you were to try to design an RC oscillator at radio frequencies, you would find that the resistors and capacitor values tend to be very, very small. It's better to use an LC oscillator, that is to use inductors and capacitors in the feedback network for the filter. That's the kind of oscillator we're going to look at in this video. We're now going to want to replace our amplifier model with that of a non-ideal amplifier. That is, an amplifier that has a non-infinite input impedance and a non-zero output impedance. This particular model is appropriate when we use a transistor amplifier. The gain across the entire amplifier A is certainly going to be less than the gain A1 of the controlled source. The feedback network of the oscillators we're going to examine in this video consists of three elements. They're labeled here as Z1, Z2, and Z3. Z referring to the impedance of the particular circuit element. It might be a capacitor, or it might be an inductor. We're going to look at both cases. We'll call this our LC oscillator base design. Let's unwrap the circuit and calculate the frequency of oscillation. First, we can use voltage division to find voltage V1 over V2. These two circuit elements are in parallel, and Z3 is our series element. We can again use voltage division to find the ratio of voltage V2 to voltage A1 V1. In blue are our parallel circuit elements. And R out is our series circuit element. To simplify the numerator, we note that Z2 is in parallel with an expression. Z2 is thus multiplied in the numerator and added in the denominator with that expression. In order to simplify this expression, I'm going to multiply every term times what we have in red brackets. I'm going to move A1 to the right side of the equation too. We now have two expressions, V1 over V2 and V2 over V1. My strategy is going to be to multiply these two expressions times one another. The product has to be 1. But I've left R in the expression, and we're going to assume that the input impedance is high even when we use a transistor. That's a very reasonable assumption to make, because the input impedance looking into the base of a bipolar junction transistor, for instance, does tend to be very high. I'm thus going to neglect the input impedance in these two expressions. If we were to use an amplifier configuration where the input is not to the base of a bipolar junction transistor or the gate of a MOSFET, for example, then neglecting Rin might not be a very good idea. Z1 plus Z3 cancels. And we might now recall that the impedance of a reactive element is J times the reactance. When I rewrite this equation, I'm going to write real numbers in black, and I'm going to write complex numbers in purple. J squared is negative 1, so the numerator is a real number. This term has 2 J squareds, so this is also a real number. Because the ratio is a real number, it means that this imaginary number has to be 0. Therefore, the sum of the three reactive elements in this circuit must be zero. From our equation up here, we know that x1 plus x3 has to be equal to negative x2. We conclude that the gain of the amplifier has to be minus x2 over x1 in order for this oscillator to have non-zero voltages V1 and V2. Note that the amplifier has to be inverting. In the box is now a summary of the oscillation conditions which we just derived. In order to design a practical circuit, we need to substitute in inductors or capacitors for these reactive elements. The first design I'm going to describe is called the Colpitts Oscillator. In the Colpitts Oscillator, reactive elements 1 and 2 are capacitors, and reactive element 3 is an inductor. For an inverting amplifier, we can use a standard common-emitting transistor configuration. Let's translate these oscillation conditions to this particular circuit. Our first reactive element is a capacitor. Our second reactive element is also a capacitor. Our third reactive element is an inductor. The magnitude of the gain of the inverting amplifier has to be C1 over C2 in order for the oscillation to sustain itself around the loop. When we actually design this circuit, we need to ensure that the magnitude of the gain exceeds C1 over C2 so that the oscillation can get started from noise and so that we can overcome any losses in the circuit. I'm going to multiply every term in this equation by omega C1 C2. We now have our frequency of oscillation. If we wanted to make the Colpitts oscillator tunable in frequency, it would be a bad idea to adjust capacitors C1 or C2 because that would change the conditions on the gain. But if we adjust inductor L3, then we can change the frequency of oscillation without affecting the gain. Let's now design a Colpitts oscillator with a nominal operating frequency of 1 megahertz. 1 megahertz is a radio frequency, so we know that we're going to need fairly small capacitors. But since I intend to actually build this circuit on a breadboard, I don't want the values of the capacitors to be so low that they start to resemble the capacitances between the plates of the breadboard. So we want the capacitors that we choose to be more than a few hundred picofarads. I'm going to choose capacitor C1 and C2 to both be 1 nanofarad. In this situation, we need to ensure that the magnitude of the gain of our common emitting amplifier exceeds 1. Because the frequency is given, however, let's first find the inductor L3. If I substitute in 1 nanofarad for each capacitor and 1 megahertz for the frequency F, we calculate a value for the inductor of 50.66 microhenries. That's a non-standard inductor value, so I plan to actually use an inductor of 47 microhenries when I actually build the circuit. That will cause the actual operating frequency of the circuit to be a little bit higher than what we planned. We've now finished designing the feedback network. These two capacitors are used for DC blocking because the transistor needs to be biased. So as long as these capacitors are large enough so that our radio frequency signal can get through them without significant attenuation, then the circuit will work. I've chosen values of 82 nanofarads. A larger capacitor value would also work. If the power supply is at 9 volts, I need to properly bias the transistor so that the base is always at a high enough voltage to keep the transistor in the forward active mode all the time. I've chosen a resistor R1 of 12 kiloohms and a resistor R2 of 8.8 kiloohms to keep the voltage at the base of the transistor below about 4 volts or so. The approximate gain of a transistor in the common emitting configuration is the collector resistor R sub C divided by the emitter resistor R sub E. So if I choose both of these resistors to be 1 kiloohm, then I should have approximately a gain of 1 across this transistor circuit. We need a gain of at least 1 in order to make the oscillator work. But in fact, we're going to have a gain higher than 1 in order to overcome additional losses in the circuit to make sure it can get started from noise. For that reason, we have a capacitor attached to the emitter through another resistor so that we can control the value of the AC gain and make sure that it exceeds 1. I've chosen a large value of 10 microfarads for this particular capacitor to maximize the gain of the transistor. The AC gain can then be tuned by this particular resistor. What's going to happen in this circuit in order to prevent the amplifier from saturating? What's going to prevent the sine wave from becoming a square wave. With the op-amp circuits, the amplifier saturated in a very clean way, but transistors don't saturate suddenly, they saturate gradually. So let's rely on the inherent nonlinear behavior of the transistor itself in order to make sure that our sine wave doesn't deviate too much from its ideal form. Since we can control the AC gain of this amplifier by adjusting this particular resistor, we can ensure that the saturation point isn't too sudden. I'm going to start off with a value of 1 kilo ohms. That will ensure that the nominal AC gain is approximately 2. We only need a gain of 1 in order for the oscillator to work. So if I were to go over to the bench and actually build it and not see a signal at all, that would be a sign that the gain is not high enough, and I would want to reduce that resistor from 1 kilo ohms to something less. If, on the other hand, I see something that too much resembles a square wave, then I can increase the size of that resistor in order to make it a little bit more beautiful. In the next video, I would like to go over to the bench and put this circuit together and see how it performs.